introduction, I'd like to tell you that thought I'd like to share the topic that crossed my mind now. Last time, my co-speaker, Rasko Mochnik, and I spoke together about NS Towers in 1985. We defended Laibach, and the moderator, Frederick Isidor, was not even alive there. So I don't think he'll be able to really judge if you have anything new to say, Rasko, but I hope we do. So, the organizers of the conference have suggested that we look at NSK as an event of the final decade of Yugoslavia. In this paper, I will look at the destruction of Yugoslavia as an event of the final decade of the Cold War. The emergence and the establishment of NSK will thus appear as an event of the final decade of the Cold War. I just talk about NSK, not about the groups, even if times I will talk of Laibach more than others. But what do we gain by such a shift of perspective? It gives us a way to reflect on the relevance of NSK today, for indeed, Cold War is back. During the 1980s, I thought the war, the Cold War, was a metaphor. That attitude was common at the time. In the circles in which I moved, we were happily consuming American pop culture, but one would have to search hard to find someone who was uncritical to the US politics. It would have been even harder to find a person in any way attracted to the USSR. We refused to identify with either side in the Cold War. That led us to think that the Cold War did not affect us. It was easy for us to trivialize or dismiss it. No warplanes were flying over our heads. People went about their business. When we saw pictures from the recent past, what then was the recent past of B-52 unloading their bombs, or heard about the devastation wrought by a strain of Agent Orange, courtesy of the same Monsanto, which is now intensely pushing in with GMOs, we saw that as hot war, not the Cold War. But I want to emphasize, the Cold War was a war. It was even, I would like to claim, the kind of war that in the Middle Ages was called Bellum Romanum, or Gea Motel, or that the Jus Gentium called War of Extermination. We were concerned in those days when the US deployed Pershings to Europe about the very extermination of humanity in a nuclear war. But a different war of extermination was being fought in front of our eyes, which we had at BBC. The Cold War was a war of extermination led by the US against an alternative social and political system, against the perceived, even against the perception of such an alternative. The Cold War was not a war to annihilate humanity. It was not the kind of war feared by all the good people organized in the peace movements. The Cold War was rather a war for annihilation of humanity's alternative futures. It was a war to the end of communism. It was a global war. Here are the roots of that globalization that was to enter the public speak after the fall of communism. And it was a total war, employing soft and hard power against the whole populations. It was aimed at total victory and total elimination of any alternative. Localized hot wars were not external to the Cold War, they were integral to it. Now, when NSK performed, they shocked most people by their appearance, by their uniforms. Not only here in Slovenia, I can remember the first emotions frozen in the air for a moment when Laibach came on stage for their first Berlin concert. I could feel the cold and fear and explosion follow and sweep them off the stage, but it all was decompressed by a little bit of boiling whistles. Now, as I, many, many years later, when I began to work on my contribution to this expedition and search for visual material to represent the political background of the 1980s, I was shocked to see how many uniforms turned up and not NSKs. There were regular armies, militias, and CIA trained death squads active all over Central and South America. There were wars in Lebanon, Kampuchea, Iran, and Iraq, Afghanistan, again, followed by the exhibition in Kuwait and Iraq again. And the Cold War probably took about as many lives as the World War II. Many political leaders, not only Yasser Arafat, but Fidel Castro, either wore uniforms or mingled with them. Think of the military junta that Maggie Thatcher with the soldiers, or Ronald Reagan with the soldiers, and giving the military salute. We live in the middle of war, and NSK managed to show by putting on uniform. That was an achievement indeed. In Yugoslavia, it was Marshal Tito who liked to wear a uniform. He did not wear it when he was going about his routine statements. He donned it at solemn occasions when the majesty of the state needed to be displayed. Toward the end, he had too many uniforms and he put them on too often. But even then, it was not a petty threat when he donned the uniform. I may not have seen it this way at the time, but now I see it as a statement of the dignity of power, as a speech of power from its symbolic core, when it does not need to threaten with spilling of blood and the breaking of bones. Tito died before our event. Looking at his successor at the helm of the state, a colleague of mine in old partisan said, Spalis konja na magarca. If Tito was like a horse, a noble animal in full of imagination, we now had an ass. We were faced with a yawning chasm between real and symbolic power, or rather with the loss of symbolic power. Laibach was formed less than a month after Tito's death. NSK had to appear to fill in the gap between real and symbolic power, to resurrect the symbolic majesty of power. Now, this is dope. But if we talk things seriously, I think one could plausibly argue that NSK responded to that gap, or to that symbolic deficit. A more cautious and perhaps more accurate formulation would be that they responded to the problem exposed by that gap in the real and symbolic power. I don't want to overstate this. I cannot specify how consciously or indirectly, how exactly, in what concrete way they perceived and understood the problem. But they must have perceived it and they expressed it from the very beginning. Their work at its heart was about understanding power, how power works. Now, how did the military authorities at the time, so after Tito's death, dealt with what I'm calling the symbolic deficit of power? The short answer would be very inaccurate. Their response to the symbolic deflation of power was the inflation of real power, which meant they stepped up repression. Within a year of Tito's departure, soldiers and police special forces were in the streets of Kosovo. I was doing my obligatory military service at the time in Belgrade, and the rumors spread that the conscripts returning from Kosovo had a whole blood in the boots. When high-ranking officers in their uniforms began to appear more often on TV and on front pages of the newspapers, when they became more visible in the League of Communists conferences, some of us built on Althusser to offer an analysis of the structural shift from the ideological apparatus of the state to the repressive apparatus. There was a kernel of truth in that analysis. That shift was unfortunate for NSK, and in the first years of the 1980s for the Laibach in particular. But was the repressions experienced a twisted acknowledgement that they had chosen the target well? When the uniform became a real threat, a direct threat to real power, they appeared as the custodians of its symbolic power. Some fared much worse than an escape. There was a string of political trials in those years. But what was most fateful of all, and fateful ultimately for the state, which was then represented or increasingly represented by the military officers usurping the place of ideology, was another thing. The shift from the ideological apparatus of the state to the repressive apparatus of the state was the Yugoslav end of ideology moment. That moment coincided with the liberalization of economy. So we have here as well, in a nutshell, the transition from capital with a capital C to capital. A most consequential political turn was taken when the Yugoslav state was at its ideological and political nadir. The end of ideology is nothing what it looks like. It does not mean disappearance of all ideology. It occurs when one ideology squeezes out or subdues its competitor or antagonist ideology. During the Cold War, the end of ideology was close when the triumph of liberal ideology was near. In the period I speak about, in the 1980s, the aggressor in the Cold War, that is the liberal camp, had advanced enough to be able to sell a representation of Cold War as a democratization process. Democratization was the public relation phase of the Cold War. Cold War years spoke the language of democracy. The language of democracy was the official language of the Cold War. Clearly, that was liberal democracy. Precisely at that time, historical revisionism went into the offensive. One of the strategic moves of that revisionism was to subsume all other, that is, non-liberal forms of democracy under either Jacobin or Bolshevik tradition, that is, under totalitarianism. The alternatives to democracy were no longer aristocracy and monarchy, or the bad forms of government, bureaucracy, oligarchy, and tyranny, but totalitarianism. Democracy ceased to be a form of government. It became a type of society, one could even say a way of life. When François Piguet, a leading revisionist historian, characterized the totalitarianism begetting French and Russian revolutions as systems of meticulous constraint over men's bodies and minds, he also characterized democracy as a system where men's bodies and minds are not constrained. It's free. Since the seat of totalitarianism and constraint is in the state power, the state needed to be reduced to minimum. The alternative mechanism of social regulation becomes the market, which allows the individuals to freely pursue their interests or rather desires. It appears to me that during the Cold War a shift appeared from interest to desire, which is an important shift, if I'm right. Structurally, desire is a perfect fit for the great transformation that culminates in neoliberalism. Unlike the common, the public interest, it would be hard to talk about common public desire. When in the 1970s, the democratization process in the East was still limited to a great degree to individual dissent, the big issue for the West were human rights. When, with the general support in the West, the dissent grew into so-called democratic opposition, and democracy came to designate a type of society, the new catchphrase became civil society. The discourse of civil society took root in Slovenia as well, not so much in other parts of Yugoslavia. It never became a common platform of the Yugoslav opposition. If anything, it split. Some specificities aside, the discourse of civil society in Slovenia was closely related to the civil society debates in other East European countries. Those of us who embrace the discourse of civil society, or perhaps whom the discourse of civil society could embrace, felt we had more in common with activists from Budapest, Warsaw, Prague, or East Berlin than with colleagues from Zagreb, Belgrade, and Sarajevo. Skopje was not even on the map. The discourse of civil society that at the time spread across Eastern Europe was an anti-communist subspecies of civil society discourse. It had very little to do with the tradition of thinking about civil societies that goes back to Hegel and the Scottish Enlightenment. Given the circumstances under which it emerged, that rediscovery of civil society was not fueled by academic interests in the first place. The motivation and the aim was to formulate a new strategy for the opposition to the Ethiopian communist regimes. The basic trait of the preceding opposition was its advocacy of democratic socialism, and occasionally of a more revolutionary socialism. That meant reforming the existing system, that is, maintaining and improving socialism. The new opposition called itself democratic against socialism or communism. I'm not going into the difference. That meant that socialism, communism had to be abandoned. On the one hand, socialism and communism were equated with the totalitarian state, which it was claimed had suffocated society. On the other hand, civil society was discovered as the site of democracy, the home of the opposition, the agent and goal of democratic change, the depository of democratic values, the standard for the present, an idea for the future. So it was now civil society against the state, democracy versus totalitarianism. The irony of that opposition, democracy versus totalitarianism, was that the basic premise in which this new democratic opposition was to rest its vision was the argument first articulated by Leszek Kołakowski and then rerun by Vaclav Havel, that totalitarianism was actually not a total system. Which was to say that it was possible to fight against communist totalitarianism because it was not really totalitarian. Above the Slovenian and broader East European landscape of the early 1980s, there appeared a bright liberal constellation. How did NSK navigate in that landscape under the skies? How did they relate, or how may we, in retrospect, relate them to all that? Let us first turn to that constraint over men's bodies and mind, and I mentioned earlier reference to here. I want to cite a question and answer from Laibach's TV interview in 1983. The host contrasted Laibach, quoting, worshipping of totalitarianism, worshipping of the state. One might even say of Nazism, Stalinism, hierarchy, manipulation of the people. He contrasted that with the genius-like thought of Edward Cadell that a man cannot be given happiness either by the state or the system or a political party, but can only create himself. Many viewers perceive Laibach's answer, which is going to quote later, as scandalous. To me, what is scandalous is the question. This is the state's TV in the period that some today never tire of calling totalitarian past. And the host comes up with equating the state with totalitarianism and then both with Nazism Stalinism. This is the gist of historical revisionism. And then the host cites Edward Cardell, the ideologist of Yugoslav socialism. Before his death, Cardell penned that thought about men's having to create his happiness by himself, because neither the state, nor the system, nor a political party could do that for him. Wash off the tinge of humaneness, and you get Margaret Thatcher. The host calls that liberal platitude a genius-like thought. Laibach responded that happiness lies in the complete abandonment of one's human identity, in the conscious repudiation of personal taste, conviction, judgment, in a free depersonalization, and in the ability to sacrifice oneself, identify with a system of value, with a mass collective ideology. What is most telling here is not associating Laibach with the state totalitarianism, Nazism, Stalinism. It is pitting them against liberalism. And I think that perception was basically accurate. How did NSK relate to civil society? I have found two direct links of NSK to civil society from the 1980s. There might be more, but I will be naming them. For one of those, I'm to blame. The other was the work of Novy Kollektivizm. I write about this all in detail in the edited volume, which is part of the exhibition project. In both cases, the recourse to civil society was made in defense of NSK. This tells us that in the mid-1980s, civil society in Slovenia had gained so much legitimacy that we thought it could extend protection to NSK. We only needed to declare them a part of civil society. But those links to civil society tell hardly anything about NSK. my tentative explanation for this discrepancy is that civil society discourse was blind to the question of power. It could gather a great destabilizing force. It had a tremendous mobilizing potential, which was used against the state to overthrow the regime. But it had no productive ideas about what to do with the captured state apparatus. What kind of state did it want to build? Did it want a state at all? How could new power structures look like? How should they relate to communist power? And because of that, because the blindness of the question of the state, civil society continues to be the perfect tool of the empire of chaos, because it is pregnant with chaos itself. So, if the civil society discourse is blind to the question of power for NSK, on the other hand, the question of power was at the core of the work, of their work. They concentrated on the symbolic dimension of power and the ritual work of the state machine. Civil society was anti-statist, or at best neutral vis-à-vis the state, NSK was state building. Let us now consider an element in the reference to civil society made by novel collectivism, which was beyond the standard civil society discourse. The context is the uproar caused by the poster for the Youth Day celebration in 1987. Novel collectivism remade Richard Klein's A Heroic Allegory of the Third Reich. To put it very, very simply, they replaced Nazi symbols by those of the socialist Yugoslavia. The remake brought up accusations of fascism against NSK. That was nothing new. The charge was there from Leiber's first appearances onward. Those were killer charges. Since the ethos that prevailed in the environment in which NSK emerged and worked was not quasi-Cardellian or Thatcherite maxim that everyone has to take care of himself, a number of us came to the defense of the accused, trying to understand why both the authorities and ordinary citizens made the charge. He suggested that fascism had not been symbolically defeated. That was why the authorities responded to NSK work with disbelief, incomprehension, and in pain, and not pain. When novel collectivism in that poster eliminated and replaced Nazi symbols, it was taking issue with Nazism symbolically. It was working on overcoming fascism symbolically. Novel collectivism was doing the work that needed to be done, that had been left undone by the generations that carried the anti-fascist liberation struggle. When novel collectivism was charged with insulting the anti-fascist struggle of the Yugoslav people, which was the foundation of the socialist Yugoslavia, it responded that by raising the negative symbolism of the somber recent past, it continued its struggle. Novel collectivism was in its own description, shouldering the moral demands bestowed upon us by the past. It demanded that the contentious poster be used in the celebrations in order to prove that the loss of 1,700,000 victims of fascism cannot be in vain. That's the number for Yugoslavia. The funny thing in its otherwise brilliant defense was that novel collectivism equated the continuation of the anti-fascist liberation struggle with the development of Yugoslav civil society. How could the collectivist and statist NSK, that repudiated personal identity, taste, conviction, and judgment, that declared that all traces of individuality were to be erased, how could they identify with the anti-statist and individualist civil society cherishing the values of unconstrained mind and body? That was NSK plain liberal. We do not need to have the knowledge of the Maidanization of civil society or of the readmittance of fascists into the political life of the ultra-liberal Europe to doubt this or any other link in civil society with anti-fascism. But at least to me, what has happened after the defeat of communism gives a clue to what is happening before it and finally getting the Cold War. Many threads are coming together here to net NSK. Communism, anti-communism, fascism and anti-fascism, liberalism, Cold War, civil society, historical revisionism, totalitarianism, statism and anti-statism, democracy. Civil society in Eastern Europe of the 1980s was organized against communism. The immediate target of its anti-statism were the Ethiopian communist regimes. The civil society discourse was part of the Cold War efforts. Democracy was the human face, or rather human mask, of the Cold War. The aim of historical revisionism was to rehabilitate fascism, and of course, to contribute to the overcoming communism. Liberalism was on the triumphant march and had suppressed other forms of democracy and hegemonized the opposition to communism. NSK has evaded that hegemonization. We have taken issue with fascist symbols and with the nature of total power with appeal to fascism and totalitarianism by both communist authorities and civil society liberals. How can we explain this? I think the clue lies, a clue lies in the triangle liberalism, communism, fascism. Historically, both communism and fascism were responses to the crisis of liberalism after World War I. Far from joining forces, fascism turned against communism, then represented mainly by Bolshevism, as its main enemy. Liberals threw their weight behind the fascists. Ludwig von Mises, a founding father of neoliberalism, praised the fascist struggle against communism, under which he mushed together social democracy and liberalism as the rescue of European civilization. He was very clear at that point. The merit which fascism thus earned will live in history forever. Von Mises excused fascist violence as reactive, as a countermeasure, as a response to communist violence. And these are all popoids that will reappear in Nolte and other revisionists more than half a century later. So, for Mises pointed out that fascism had not rejected all liberal beliefs and ideas. There was thus a liberal element in fascism, whereas communism is totally alien to and the bitterest enemy of both European and human civilization. And these are all quotes from Mises' Liberalism from 1927. Historical contingencies, which we still understand quite poorly, led to a war against fascist powers in which liberal democratic countries formed an uneasy and temporary alliance with the Soviet Union. The world order that emerged from the war rested on the anti-fascist consensus. However, whereas Franco's Spain was left alone, an uncompromising struggle against communism was launched in Europe, brutal in Greece, unrelenting in Italy. Across the Atlantic, the US government used the army to break the biggest labor protest in the history of the country. The Cold War was a systematization of its efforts. NSK emerged in the period when the old affinities between liberalism and fascism began to be resurrected. The rehabilitation of fascism began in earnest. NSK's taking issue with what appeared as totalitarianism caused so much unease because it could not be reduced to the critique of communism. Even had they not proclaimed themselves heirs of the national anti-fascist liberation struggle, their confrontation with the symbols, with the symbolic power of fascism could not be overlooked or dismissed. That was precisely what one should not have been reminded of at the time when fascism was to be made acceptable. What started in the early 1980s initiated a big transformation. Historically, following from Mises, liberalism was an inner element of fascism. Now, fascism was to become an inner moment of liberalism. Fascism was being incorporated into liberalism as its productive force, with the help of which the Cold War was to be fought to a successful end in the defeat of communism. That transformation is still underway today and may well end up in a fascization of liberalism. In a way, this is good news because it will ensure that NSK work will continue to be relevant. With the demise of communism, liberal imperium became quasi-total. I do not need to enter a discussion about the merits and demerits of communism. What's important for my argument is that the presence of communism determined the structure of global order in such a way that it held the liberal system in check. Liberalism with its capitalism was appealing not so much in contrast to communism, but because the structural presence of communism restrained it from setting free its worst qualities. With that counterweight gone, it went free, it is so in horror, wreaking havoc. But a system without an alternative, that is a system with no limit or control, is totalitarian. With totalitarianism, it seems to be just like slavery. Notwithstanding all the pompous rhetoric about freedom and liberty, liberalism had not abolished slavery, but had created modern slavery. With a cannonade against totalitarianism, liberalism has not eliminated totalitarianism, but seems to be creating a totalitarianism of its own. This too is promising. It's promising a continuing relevance to any scope.